So what we're going to do here is a Hermite interpolation. I'll describe this as a relatively simple example. Relatively simple example. Now, the word relatively is in there because it doesn't mean it really is that simple, but compared to the general case, it's going to be fairly simple. Let's say we've got three nodes, an x0, an x1, and an x2. Oh, let's pick x0 to be 2, x1 to be 4, and how about x2 to be not 6? Let's not make these equally spaced. Let's make it be 7 for the sake of doing unequally spaced values. With Hermite interpolation, it's a generalization of Lagrange interpolation. Not only are you trying to match function values, but also derivative values. Assume f of x0 is known. In other words, f of 2 is known, and let's pretend it's 5. The derivative of f at x0 is also known, and let's pretend it's negative 2. F of x1 is known. In other words, f of 4 is known. Let's pretend it's about 1. Just making these up on the fly. F prime of x1 is also known. F prime of 4. Let's pretend that's also 1, just for the sake of showing you you can do that. F of x2 is known. F of 7. Let's pretend that is 6. And f prime of x2, f prime of 7 is also known. Let's pretend that's negative 3. Okay, so I got essentially 6 data values. 3 of them are pure function values. 3 of them are derivative values. I'm after an interpolating polynomial that will match all these values. What am I going to need? We should be able to get away with a fifth degree polynomial, because a fifth degree polynomial is going to have 6 unknown constants. Let's use a suggestive notation. Instead of calling the polynomial P, let's call it H in honor of Hermite. It's going to be fifth degree, so I'll make the subscript 5. Not that you have to use a subscript. H5 of x. Let's make it be a times x to the fifth plus b times x to the fourth plus c times x cubed plus d times x squared plus e times x, that e is not the number e, plus, oh, should I use an f again? That seems to be a problem. Okay, well, this f is not the same as the other f. Are we okay with that? Okay, let's use g. F is a function, g is a number. We're going to need the derivative, and I hope it's pretty clear the method you could use here. Just plug in the numbers and solve the resulting system of equations. Oops, let's see, I made a mistake there. 3cx squared plus 2dx plus e. Plug in all the data values. Get a system of equations of 6 equations and 6 unknowns. 6 linear equations, in fact, and 6 unknowns. The 6 unknowns would be A, B, C, D, E, and G. Sounds like a job for technology. Uh-huh. And let's go ahead and jump right to, in Mathematica, the matrix that we would use to do row operations to get the answer. I'll call that matrix A. Six equations, six unknowns. And if this is going to be an augmented matrix, I'll need seven columns. Control column, comma adds columns. There's 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 columns. Control return adds rows. I've got 2 rows now. 3, 4, 5, 6 rows. All right. How quickly can we do this here? Let's first use the function values instead of the derivative values. So I'm focused on just the H5 here and the constants A, B, C, D, E, and G. I made this a bit painful for myself because I didn't make any of the inputs 1. So I have to raise 2 to powers and 4 to powers and 7 to powers. So 2 to the 5th power is 32. 2 to the 4th power is 16. 2 to the 3rd, 2 to the 2nd, 2 to the 1st. That's got to equal 5, right? So this is corresponding to the fact. Yes, thank you. This is corresponding to the fact that I want h of 2 to equal 5 because f of 2 equals 5. So I'm doing 2 to the 5th, 32a plus 16b plus 8c plus 4d plus 2e plus g equals 5. The 5 is the right-hand side number. If this is an augmented matrix, maybe you'd make it like a dashed line there by hand. Now go to this one, f of 4 equals 1. 4 to the 5th is the same as 2 to the 10th, 1028, I think. Is that right? No, 1024. Then I got 4 to the 4th, which will be 256. 4 cubed, 64. 4 squared, 16. 4 to the 1st, 1, 1. That last one is because I want f of 4 to equal 1. Oh, 7 higher powers. Okay, let's just do this. 7 to the 5th power, 7 to the 4th power, 7 cubed, 7 squared, 7, 1, 6, right? Because I want f of 7 to equal 6. Now let's go to the derivative values. First, plug in 2, get a 5 times 2 to the 4th. 2 to the 4th is 16 times 5 is what, 80? 80. 4 times 2 cubed, 2 cubes, 8 times 4 is 32. 2 squared is 4 times 3 is 12. 2 times 2 is 4. I get a 1, then a 0. There's no g here. In other words, it's 0 times g. Don't forget that 0. That's got all equal negative 2. Next one is when f prime of 4 equals 1. 4 to the 4th is 256 times 5. I'll just do 5 times 256. And 4 times 4 cubed. Okay, save time here. And then the last one, 5 times 7 to the 4th, 4 times 7 cubed, 3 times 7 squared, 2 times 7, 1, 0 again, equals negative 3. So if I've not made a mistake, check over that. That should be my augmented matrix that I want to go to RREF for to solve for A, B, C, D, E, and G. I'm sure these fractional values that you will get for them will be kind of nasty, but it is what it is. Row reduce will do that in Mathematica, and you can do matrix form to get the output in a nice way. Matrix form here with a slash slash at the end. There are those beautiful fractions that are the answers. and then take that output and do / capital N to get numerical approximations, not in matrix form, but so it looks like A is about 0.0267407. B is this, then C, then D, then E, then G. So it looks like H5 of X should be approximately, let's go ahead and type it in with the decimals, 0.0267407 X to the fifth minus 0.709185 X to the fourth plus 6.80007 X cubed minus 28.7585 X squared plus 51.9879 X minus 27.851. Does this have the approximately right function values at 2, 4, and 7, and the right derivative values at those same nodes? I'm sure it's off a little bit because of rounding, but let's see how close they are. 2, 5, 1, 6, negative 2, 1, and negative 3. Not bad. Okay. And then you can plot it. And you could also plot the data if you wanted to. From 2 to 7. There's what it ends up looking like. The point here at 2, 5 is a data point with slope negative 2. 4, 1 is a data point with slope positive 1. And 7, 6 is a data point with slope negative 3. And that's the minimum degree polynomial that will satisfy those conditions, the unique minimum degree polynomial. Is it truly matching the underlying function? Well, that's more debatable, right? You probably want nodes that are closer together, like, you know, 0.1 apart or 0.2 apart, to be more confident that it's matching the function. But then you're going to need more nodes and you're going to need more data. You're going to need a higher degree polynomial. In general, the polynomial that you need is 2n plus 1 when you've got n plus 1 nodes. You've got 3 nodes here. N plus 1 is 3, so n is 2. 2n plus 1 then would be 2 times 2 plus 1 is 5. You'll see that in the book. This is in general 2n plus 1 when you've got n plus 1 nodes. The last subscript is n. And again, the book gives you a general description of how to construct this without doing all this linear algebra. Now, the linear algebra is easier conceptually because the book's description is all this stuff. You're very, very complicated. I will tell you very briefly what's going on here. You are constructing this as a linear combination of polynomials h and h hat. And h hat are constructed using Lagrange polynomials and their squares. In weird ways, very mysterious ways, these crazy formulas, I will tell you, do result in functions that have very simple function values and derivative values at the nodes. Ones, a bunch of ones and zeros. I've got, as you know now, these extra videos from 3 years ago where I show how that works in an example. The H and the H hat have very simple values, ones and zeros, for both the outputs and the derivative values at the nodes. That's how they're constructed. It's definitely not clear how that works just looking at these things.